This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
All right, welcome back to Election Day coverage on the Earl Ingram Show. And Sandy, I'm just the lyrics of these songs. Golden.
Yeah, they're golden. This is McCartney and Stevie Wonder. But, you know,
all of them are,
you know, they might have been about other kinds of divides that we've had, but they're all about cultural, sociological divides and the need to overcome them. And so, you know, that's to me, Election Day needs to be a hopeful day. So that's what this is all about.
All right. So you're tuned into the Earl Ingram Show. It's Election Day Tuesday with my co-host Sandy Williams. And we're taking your thoughts, whatever they may be, 855-752-4842. Let's go to Chad from Greenfield. Good morning to you, Chad. You say what?
All right, you guys. Well, first of all, before I begin, I want to say a big congratulations and thank you to the GOAT, the godfather of talk radio, Mr. Mark Belling. Without him, we wouldn't be talking right now. Earl, you wouldn't have a career on the radio. I think we all should be grateful for him.
So wait a minute. So what makes you think I wouldn't have a career on radio?
You started calling his show.
Yeah, that gave you a voice, and
I think it's pretty apparent, but that's okay. Yeah.
Well, it wasn't just anyway, him. He wasn't the only show I called, just for the sake of clarity.
Yeah, but he's the biggest show in Wisconsin.
Okay, all right.
Either way, go ahead. You're thankful and be grateful. But second of all, you know, I'm listening to this. You guys sort of pass hour. You guys sound dead. You guys sound defeated. I think you guys know what's about to come. What happened to the party of joy? You guys sound deflated. I think deep down, you know, the internals are looking bad. The gambling lines went up again 20% this morning. Your firewall is burned in Pennsylvania and other states.
Let me cut you off. Let's not count our chickens before they hatch, okay? You know, if you're a gambling man, you've just cursed yourself. So I wouldn't declare victory, quite so early. The strategy might be to declare victory early and then ask people to prove why you didn't win. But we're not going to have it on this radio show.
Well, because I don't think we said anything about that. Kamala Harris is going to lose. Where did you get that?
Well, I think I think that there needed to be no opening. I think this was a call with a purpose. But
Chad, we never said. I'm confident that the American people aren't going to make the same mistake they made before in putting a man who is clearly not well into that position again. Okay, so I'm more than confident that that's going to be the outcome.
You guys sound depressed and sad. I think you know what's coming, a party of joy. I just don't feel it, but I just want to know what your excuse is going to be tomorrow. Is it going to be racism, misogyny?
Well, let me ask what is yours going to be?
No, I mean, you talk about the party of excuse. We have a party that lost 4 years ago who still claims that the election was rigged, you know, that they didn't lose, the excuse is that the election process itself is somehow defective when the victory bell isn't rung on the right side. So, you know, it's enough of this call. This is silliness. Silliness.
Let's go to Susan from Kenosha. Good morning to you, Susan. You say what?
Good morning. I got up early this morning, and I was at the polling place at 7 o'clock. I was so overjoyed. I can't even tell you how many cars are in the parking lot. And also, I have to tell you, all the young people that I stood in line with, it took about a half hour to vote this morning. And but I was overjoyed to see this, to see such a turnout. And no matter what happens, no matter what happens, we will still march on. We will still work toward a better tomorrow. And one of the things that early this morning when I got up and I was looking at my phone, I didn't know that Dick Van Dyke was so involved in 1964. He stood on the platform with Martin Luther King at one of Martin Luther King's speeches. And I was astonished at he got up this morning and he read a speech that actually Rod Sterling wrote. And just this one portion of this speech, I would just like to read for the people. There will be moments of violence and expressions of hatred as ugly echo of intolerance proceeds. But these are the clinging vestiges of a decay of the past, not the future, not the Behringer of a better and clean future. And that's exactly what's happening. That is exactly what's happening. And Rod Sterling wrote that. He was the writer of The Twilight Zone. So I, in myself, was just at reading this and seeing what I saw at the polling place, I am elated. I am happy. People are getting involved. And united we stand, for divided we shall fall. And I think this particular race has united the people, and that's all I have.
Hey, Catherine, you said a lot. I mean, you invoke Rod Serling, so.
And sometimes yeah. I have felt like we've been in the Twilight Zone.
Yeah. Let's go to Brendan from New Jersey. Hey, good morning to you, Brendan. You say what?
I'm so happy that earlier clown gave us a preview of what we're going to get at 11 p.m. this evening when the other clown with the orange face comes out and tries to tell everybody they've already won the election, because that's going to happen. But, you know, CJ is the perfect example of what's going on in that party right now, making lame excuses about how they've been cheated already. It's a great day. I feel positive. I feel there's a real movement in the country towards people wanting to save our Constitution and our democracy and not vote this criminal into office. And even his rallies have just gone down to nothing. I thought if you watched Kamala's rally last night in Philadelphia, it was incredibly produced. They were in multiple cities, jumping from one city to the next. I feel there's a lot of energy behind what's going on. I've moved, so I have to drive about 30 to 45 minutes to go vote. I'm going to wait for my daughter to get off work, and we're all going to go vote as a family. So keep the positive thoughts. And let's move forward.
Hey, Brendan, thank you very much for the call. Let's go to Melissa from Kenosha. Thank you very much for the call. You say what?
Good morning. I just wanted to say I'm really enjoying your show.
Thank you.
Today and every day, but especially today, it's, you know, giving me the calm and hope that I needed today.
Hey, Melissa, thank you very much for listening. And tell somebody about us. We really appreciate it, and I felt your spirit. Let's go to Brian from McGuanago. Good morning to you, Brian. You say what?
Well, right off the bat, now I'd like to say that, hey, Melissa, we're all in this together. So keep your head up, and we'll get through it no matter what else comes today. But I'm positive that Kamala is going to win, and we're going to have a brighter future. But I want to mention something about the goofball caller a few callers ago. And something about CJ the other day, and yesterday, actually, and they were talking, some of the other callers were talking about, like, can we just ban CJ because of the ridiculousness? And I want to say, in regards to that, in regards to this goofball that just called a few minutes ago, I don't think we should ban any caller. I think we need everyone to call in, whether or not we think their ideas are ridiculous or we disagree with them. We need them calling in. Otherwise, we create our own echo chamber. And that, as we can see, all see, is a slippery slope. And I just wanted to throw that out.
Hey, Brian, let me also add this. And what I love about what you just said, more than all the other great things you said, what I love the most was you said we. And, you know, Sandy and I, that's what we attempt to do every day is include everybody. And I love the fact that you said we.
Yeah, and I think the echo chamber is the important concept. I think what we need to avoid are echo chambers. We don't need amen corners. We need listening processes, and we need colloquy and dialogue.
All right. Let's go to Joe from Milwaukee. Good morning to you, Joe. You say what?
Well, just listening to some of the calls, I'm a conservative, and I do like to listen to opposing opinions. And, you know, when you call people goofballs, is that really listening? Is that really inclusive? I find it strangely ironic that, you know, you have that kind of verbiage that's tossed at people with a different perspective. And I'm disappointed in that. I don't need to call you a name just because you don't agree.
Hey, Joe, I agree with you.
We didn't use that term, actually.
And do you say that, Joe, when you listen to conservative talk radio and it's constantly, you know, attacking and beating up people? I listen to conservative talk radio every day, sir, and have for the better part of 30 years, 40 years almost.
I do, but when you have the current president calling, you know, 250 million people track garbage, I guess, yeah, it seems pretty disingenuous.
So hang on a second. Calvin, you want to respond to this gentleman? We'll give you an opportunity to respond to him.
Well, I just, like, 250 million is, that can't be the number. There's only 330 million people in the country.
Well, and the other thing is that, you know, whether that Joe Biden, it's not clear what he said when he used the term garbage, whether he was referring to the words that were being used as garbage or whether it was pointed at people. But the White House tried to clarify that later and back off from that. But I think you've got a candidate. I think this would be calling the kettle the wrong color because you've got a candidate who spends all of his time describing his opposition with very negative terms. You know, I don't know whether Marxist or communist or devil. I don't know what these things are, but they're not positive.
All right. 855-752-4842. You're tuned in to the Earl Ingram Show.
You're listening to Civic Media. Stay up to date on the latest news and information for your local community and Wisconsin by signing up for our free email newsletter. Visit civicmedia.us/email to get started.
All right. Welcome back to an Election Day edition of the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 855-752-4842. My co-host Sandy Williams is here. And Sandy, I will say this. I am so pleased about our listening audience and the growth of it and the diversity of it and the intellect of our audience. It's grown.
Well, and I am glad that we have all different views, and you know, I don't mean to cut off people who necessarily, but one thing I think what we're not looking for is people who call only with the purpose of spouting talking points. What we're interested in is conversation and about issues. When we get past this election, I think we're going to find out we're going to have shows that'll be dealing with substantive things, and hopefully we can move on in the direction of having lots of diverse views expressed on the subjects we're talking about.
No, absolutely. 100% accurate. Let's go to the phone lines. And Charles from Milwaukee, good morning to you, Charles. You say what, man?
Hey, good morning, guys. Great conversation this morning. Yes, as a country, we need to come together. There's so much division in our country, but I think it's ironic that Trump supporters, almost like they have amnesia. Maggie Dawn the other day played us, it was about a 45-second clip of all the times that Donald Trump has called Democratic constituents trash, scum,
yes.
Marxist, communist. Yes. And it's almost like they forget that. Just last night, he referred to her as the B word. J.D. Vance
yes.
called her trash. Not once have I heard Kamala Harris say anything derogatory about Trump, Vance, or the Republican constituents. But they made sure to talk about her. And the two campaigns are, there's a stark difference. Donald Trump's whole campaign has been just dark. I mean, completely dark. And her campaign has been all about hope and happiness and bringing people together. And it's almost like they have amnesia and they forget all the horrible things. I don't think there's a day that goes by that Donald Trump does not say something about somebody. Pencil neck Schiff. He was talking about Adam Schiff last night.
I know.
I mean, that's your closing argument, is to talk about people. One of the things, I worked in NPS for 18 years before I had my transplant. I worked with kids at a group home. We talk kids. You don't bully other kids. And we have grown folks at his rallies that laugh, thinking it's funny. And if their kid came home and said that they were being bullied, they would go up to school and they would be really mad that their kid was being bullied. But they laugh at someone that wants to be the most powerful, hold the most powerful office in the world. And they laugh at things that he says about people. What does that say about us as people, that we laugh at somebody that makes fun of other people?
Hey, Charles, man, right on point as always. I mean, very well said. Sandy, another text message. What are we all supposed to be, 6 years old again? Because there's a hell of a lot of people that are acting like toddlers. I want my way. I don't want anything to change. Just don't feel comfortable. You know, there's going to be a winner and a loser. There always is in competition, right?
Yeah.
And so we've learned. I know I ran a sports league for 20 years, and I struggled constantly to tell people there's winners and losers in competition. That's at the root of competition, right?
Ultimately, teams have to accede to the outcome, right? I remember there was a Seattle Seahawks game with a very controversial play at the end of it, which would have made the game go the other direction. And when you looked at it afterwards, the call should have gone the other direction. But the Seahawks couldn't claim victory in a game that you lost, right? So, you know, that's been our, you know, what we need is this peaceful acquiescence to the outcome of something that might be very close. We our elections have for quite a while been very close, but somebody has to win. And if the election is forever contested and never accepted, ultimately our system falls apart.
Is it unrealistic for us to expect adults to act like adults? I mean, at the root of what we're talking about here is what I just read in this text message. We should expect adults to act like adults. Right. I tell children all the time, things aren't going to always go your way. That's part of the lessons we teach children, right?
Yeah, there seems to be some sort of regression in terms of civil norms, and particularly one of the civil norms that might be regressing is the definition of adulthood and the civility and the norms that are associated with operating and acting like an adult. Because we have a person on stage who constantly is testing that norm, I'll tell you.
Yes. Well, that's 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. Sandy, I want to explore what we just got through talking about a little deeper. Phone lines are open, you guys. Your thoughts on the outcome, what you saw today. I'm a guy who votes the day of, so I'll be leaving here and going to my voting place, and I can generally judge the outcome by the numbers when I get there. All right, 855-752-4842.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Love is but a song we sing, fears we will die. You can make the mountains ring, or make the angels cry. Those are bird ears on the wing, and you may not.
All right, welcome back to, the election edition of the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 855-752-4842. Your thoughts, we're going to keep it going to the end of the show. And, on today's election, let's go to Gary from Sussex. Good morning, Gary. You say what?
I voted early about a week ago or so. First time in my life I've ever done that. There weren't a lot of people out in Sussex at that time. It was during the daytime. I had a day off. But I do want to say something that I've been listening. I was watching MSNBC this weekend, and they were talking about Trump wanting to put Liz Cheney in front of a firing squad. And if he said that, I wouldn't vote for him.
Gary, hang on. Because you always say, if he said that. You didn't hear him say that. Every time Trump says something outrageous, you say you didn't hear him say that. Even though it's out there for you to find, very easy to find. He said it.
Actually, Gary, you talked about this yesterday when you called in. What he said or whether he said that, Bill Maher or others have tried to figure out what it was he was trying to say. But he did talk about having 9 guns trained on her face.
It was unnecessary.
And it was just the notion of talking about it in those violent terms. But in any case, we're at election day, and a huge portion of the people we're talking to have probably already voted, and another portion of them are headed out to vote. But can we avoid going through all that laundry? We did it yesterday, actually, with you, Gary, so I'm not quite sure why you wanted to bring it up again today.
No, you hung up on me. Sandy, I just wanted to know, did he say that? Or was
on the clip, what he said was that he was talking about her and talking about her being someone who always wanted to go to war, and that Liz Cheney was a warmonger, that she would come to his office regularly when he was in presidency wanting to go to war. I'm sure that was apocryphal. And secondly, that how would she behave if she had a gun in her hand and had 9 rifles focused on her face, okay? And so it's not clear what he was trying to say, but using the notion of 9 rifles trained on her face was a strange description of what a firing squad does, and it was a totally unnecessary way of talking about it. And I think yesterday what I responded to you was that my problem with Donald Trump is that he's talking in terms of violence all of the time. He talks about going backstage and knocking the hell out of people. He talks about a lot of things, and it just strikes me as unnecessary violent talk.
Especially for a man who wants to be the president of the United States.
Yeah, but Sandy and Earl, he was making a point.
Hey, Gary, see, you're making excuses.
This is
enough of the excuses for what Donald Trump is saying.
This is replowing the ground from yesterday, and whatever your version is of what it was he was trying to do, it was all a lot of unnecessary talk about violence, and with talking about nine rifles focused and aimed at her face was just something that no president should be talking about with respect to a political opponent.
But
in any case, today's election day, and we're done with this.
When? That's what I say. And then tomorrow or the next day or whatever we figure out, we all get along. Because, Earl, you and I and Sandy, we've all been getting along for 8 years now. And the fact is, we have to do this.
Hey Gary, thank you very much for the call.
Well, that's true. I mean, you know, I think that's the point. In the future, we need to figure out a way to get along. But hopefully, whoever is in office will not continue to sow the seeds of division.
Let's go to Rob from West Dallas. Good morning to you, Rob. You say what?
Morning, gentlemen. Just as people go into that voting booth, I want them to remember integrity, right? So I watch these ads. And, you know, they say Trump won't do an abortion ban. Yeah, he won't do it at the federal level. They're just going to pass, you know, 50 state ones. Or this horrible ad they run against Tammy Baldwin, where they act like she stepped down with the Boston bomber and gave him a COVID check. I mean, it's so smacks of a lack of integrity. And then, you know, I wish it would be over, like after the election. I feel really good that I think that Kamala is going to win. But they're already planting the seeds for election fraud. So I don't know if you guys saw Ron Johnson. What a freaking disappointment. He was on either Fox or Fox Business claiming election fraud to Neil Cavuto. And when Neil pushed him on it, he had nothing. So, I mean, you need to think about that. You know, 40 years of supply side Reaganomics hasn't been working for the middle class. And these people are complete liars. They don't have any integrity. How can you vote for them? Republicans are fine, but some of these politicians are really slimy with their half truths.
You know, Robert, it is absolutely true that Ron Johnson, who we had on a couple of weeks ago.
Well, and in fact, he had already started the process. When asked the question of, you know, would he honor the outcome of the election, he jumped the track. He jumped the shark, is what he jumped, and went off already talking about all the ways that the prior election had been stolen, setting the table for claiming the same thing this time around, I guess.
Well, and that's why, Robert, as you stated, it's going to be hard for there to be peace, not because, again, I think there's no question that if Donald Trump wins the election, you're not going to see mass numbers of Democrats saying the election was stolen. I think there will be, not very many, if any, who will be saying that. Robert, but if the shoe's on the other foot, nonstop, we're going to continue to hear that the election was stolen, not just by politicians, but by average everyday citizens who have been fed this garbage.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the notion that 2016, that the Democrats after 2016 talked about the social media kinds of things that might have affected how people voted, but they weren't asserting that the election had been improperly stolen or the votes improperly counted or that the president, in fact, wasn't the president. There was a discussion about the effect of potential social media disinformation, and we continue to face that, and we face it now with our eyes open and understanding that there are meddlesome people out there with ill intent trying to use social media.
All right, let's go to Rocky from Madison. Good morning to you, Rocky. Thank you very much for calling. You say what, sir?
Good morning. Everybody should cheer up. It's time to be winners, celebrate, have a cigar. Because I've got ESPN. ESP is extra sensory perception, and N is not always. But I'll tell you something. Simple math tells me 160 million people voted last time. 80 million were women. 80 million men. We get 80 million women vote for the right person, and half the men, that's 120. We win 120 to 40. Trump proves it. He's a loser. So let's get a cigar and celebrate, guys. It's that time.
Hey, Rocky, I wish we could be so sure. Thank you very much for the call. Let's go to Justin from Maguanago. Good morning to you.
Hey, how you doing, guys?
All right. You say what?
I say that I see a lot of interesting things around me. I see a lot of energy in a lot of different directions. I see a lot of energy going to Trump in this area, and especially in Waukesha as well. Now, I'm a younger person. I spend my time with a lot of younger people. You'd be shocked at the amount of younger people that want to vote and are going to vote Trump today. And especially early. Like, the amount of people in my life that are voting early right now is out of control. It's just very surprising compared to the last 8 years.
Well, so I would say to you, hang on, that, you know, what you see in Waukesha and other places, that's in that area. But I can tell you in the city of Milwaukee, the largest city in the entire state, you know, I see the exact opposite for the most part. So, you know, that energy that you're seeing is good, but that energy is being duplicated all over this nation, Sandy, in different places.
Well, I think there is a notion that Trump might excite people who are infrequent voters who are anti-establishment. My view is the more voters we have, the better. And regardless of how they vote, it's part of the democratic process. And if we can activate everybody, and if we can avoid suppressing anybody, then I think the outcome will be what it will be, and we will have a government that is premised on the vote of the people. And so, you know, I applaud big votes and big votes from any segment, but I wouldn't be lighting any cigars yet on any side. And I think what we need to have is a big vote and a big with a big vote. And I think we should understand that there is a party that doesn't appreciate big votes, okay? And there's a party that has tried to make it hard to vote with a very significant purpose in mind. And so, in the long run, I think what you're talking about is great. And in the short run, it's great. But I think you should recognize that big votes and big turnouts are what everyone should want, but everyone doesn't want that.
You know, I think, Justin, it's great to have a young man like you listening to the show, number one, and also being engaged with younger people. So we appreciate that.
Of course, and I appreciate your show.
Well,
and
thank you.
I gotta say, too,
go ahead.
I happen to be on the other side of the fence, but I agree. The more voting, better. And I love the fact that people are taking more advantage of early voting, because I want to hear what people have to say. I think the more the people get engaged in this process, the better off everybody is. And no matter what side you're on, I'm just so glad that I just really want people to have dynamic, rich conversations to really discuss what's going on so we can just help each other out. Because at the end of the day, we just want to take care of each other, and we really don't want these kind of things to divide us.
Hey, you know, man, you're very, absolutely, very encouraging, and thank you very much, man. Very well said. Let's go to Jake from Milwaukee. Good morning to you, Jake. You say what?
Hey, good morning, guys. Thanks for taking my call.
Oh, yeah.
I just have a genuine question for you guys. So let's say Harris wins and, you know, Trump does all his ranting and raving, early declaration and saying fraud and all that stuff. What can he actually do in terms, like, what's the worst case scenario of him interfering, delaying any of that? Can he actually do anything other than just rile up his cult following?
Well, there's been an effort on the part of the Republican Party to install into the voting apparatus in a whole variety of states a far more partisan process. And there is this theory of the legislative, the sole power of the legislature to do and control voting. And there are extreme right-wing folks who would want the legislature in a state where the people might vote Democrat to decide that the Electoral College votes will be selected by the state legislature and therefore might send Republican votes to the Electoral College even though the Democrats won the state in a plurality. And so, you know, there's all these legal theories at play that are going to be tested, apparently. And it's all part of this process of testing the norms and contesting the norms. And so can there be mischief? I fear there can be. And there needn't be mischief in many states if we have a very tight Electoral College vote for it to be a problem in the long run.
Hey, Jake, thank you very much for the call. 855-752-4842 as we wind down. An election day show on the Earl Ingram Show. Phone lines are still open. You will understand. Listen. You hold the key to love and fear. All in your trembling hand. Just one key unlocks them both. There at your command. Come on, people now. Smile on your brother. Everybody gets together. You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us. No, Sandy, I got to tell you, music's been exemplary.
Today's been good music, I have to say. Turns out there's a big assortment of positive stuff.
All right. Welcome back to what are the last few minutes of an election day morning on the Earl Ingram Show. So I haven't voted yet. I'm the kind of guy who always waits until election day. And
You probably kept your kids waiting to go down and see if Santa Claus had been there. It's all part of the ritual,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's the way it used to be.
Yeah.
Couldn't open the gifts until the next morning.
Right.
And not during the, I've seen people allow them to open them during the evening, Christmas Eve. But no, I'm a stickler for, you're talking to the guy who watches movies from the 40s and the 50s, so.
Ritual.
Yeah.
Your ritual will be in about an hour. You'll be casting your vote.
Yeah, traditionalist. And so I will be voting. And I'm looking forward to seeing, you know, the people on election day. And, you know, we've had.
I voted early on the 29th. I stood in line to do that. So, you know, this is going to be a very big turnout day.
We've had a great group of callers. I always say that the success of this program is because of you, the listeners. And so Sandy and I are very appreciative of the fact that you guys, you know, get up and call us.
I think it was Justin from McConaughey. I was really happy, you know, as apparently a conservative leaning young man who was what he was interested in is one, a big turnout, and two, a dialogue between folks, and I think he was listening to the show because maybe that's what we try to offer. So that's good.
Well, tomorrow will be a continuation of you and your thoughts, because as Sandy stated, Sandy, you don't think the outcomes. I tell you one thing that's going to happen for sure tonight. Donald Trump is going to declare victory.
I'm sure he's already made it clear that's what's going to happen. I think tomorrow we will have a far better view of what happened in the House and the Senate, which obviously ends up being very important. Most frequently, the president wins and wins the Troika and wins the House and the Senate, and for 2 years is in a position to actually accomplish policy that might be aimed in the direction of what the party is that's in control. But I'm thinking this time that's maybe not as likely, and so we'll find out.
You know, the House, the Senate, all of them are razor thin, and this nation is divided right down the middle.
It is, and it's not clear, I think we're going to find out in the long term, whether the division is actually as strong as it might feel in terms of the view of the majority of the people. Because there is a growing, I think, center, which is interested in potentially accomplishing things. And we've had for a long time gridlock, particularly in every circumstance in which there hasn't been the Troika in effect. And we've had a divided House and White House. We've had gridlock, and we've had little or nothing accomplished. And Biden began to accomplish things bipartisanly, and maybe we're headed in the direction of having what was used to be called the quiet majority, silent majority. Maybe, in fact, they'll start rearing their head.
You know, Sandy, I just wish that there was a way we could put the genie back in the bottle. And these commercials that are so misleading, so hurtful.
Yeah.
You know, just totally untrue. And they know that they're lying, and yet they put it out there anyway. And then we have a news media that by law can't not show it. There's this one, again, that shows an aborted fetus, well, baby, kind of. And it looks so horrible. And it's such a horrible, horrible commercial that they say after it in white letters on a black background, by law, we're forced to show this.
Well,
But we don't support this.
Yeah, my hope is we can drop the notion that political campaigns are crusades, you know, that where we're a blood sport, where we're actually pitted against one another because there is an enemy within, all of this kind of thing. Hopefully we can somehow get it behind us. I think it's more likely to get behind us depending on the outcome here, but hopefully we can get it behind us regardless of the outcome.
You know, and you would hopefully say that all that negative ads, all those negative ads that once somebody lost, they could be and say, well, congratulations to my opponent. I used to tell, you know, when I was running my league, after the games, everybody had to shake hands. The kids had to shake hands.
Yeah.
Whether they liked it or not. That's what we should do.
Well, anyone who watches an NFL game notices that at the end of the game, there's a lot of love expressed between the participants who were hard at it during the game. And hopefully we can have that same kind of unity after this. And you know, we have to be dedicated to that principle, though. And people are going to have to unsee and unthink some of the things that they've seen and thought during the campaign in order to get there.
Well, thank everybody. Sandy, thank you especially. I'll see you again on tomorrow. Thank everybody who made the show go. Up next, Jane Madnair and Greg Bach, Madnair on Air. Get out and vote. I know I got to do my due diligence. See you guys on tomorrow.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.